You have probably heard many explanations to debunk the flat earth theory, but I bet you haven't heard this one. One of our videos was picked up by a flat earth YouTube channel and was made the topic of their daily discussion. It is hard to believe that some people think the earth is flat, honestly. They can believe what they will, but our video actually wasn't trying to make any arguments that the earth is spherical. We just assumed the earth was spherical and did the corresponding math. It must have been a slow flat earth news day. So I thought, if they want to have a real video to discuss, I will make them one. In this video, we discuss a few mathematical evidences that the spherical model fits reality much better than the flat earth model does. There is a really nice website that has put together a ton of evidences. If you are interested in tossing things to the flat earth community to think about, the link is in the description. But in this video, I offer one new argument. I call it proof by albatross. First, let's examine a few of my favorite globe earth evidences. Flat earthers often claim that the earth rises to meet the level of the horizon. However, if you extend lines that are parallel to the ground in a photograph or drawing, they consistently intersect above the horizon in the image. You can test this yourself. For example, I found a photo taken from a skyscraper in London, where extending the window lines clearly shows them intersecting above the horizon. Flat earthers dismiss this by claiming that atmospheric interference prevents us from seeing the true horizon that far out. However, this argument falls apart in cases where a tall object is visible in the background. For instance, a tall building in Sweden appears to drop below the horizon as you approach Denmark. This observation alone challenges flat earth claims, but combining it with a perspective test strengthens the case. Even when a tall structure is in view, the extended parallel lines still intersect above the horizon, showing that this is not the limited sight distance that is causing the effect. The spherical Earth model also predicts the effect that we see in this image. This is where so many flat Earth claims fall apart. The globe model gives very accurate predictions to experiments that the flat Earth model fails, or gives much worse predictions for. Let's take view E from this image. The water appears about halfway up the building. Using the math of the spherical Earth, that is about what we expect. We can use the Pythagorean theorem like we used in a previous video. Assuming the Earth has a radius of 6,378.1 meters, and the information on the infographic, viewing from an elevation of 2.7 meters and a distance of 45 kilometers away, we get that the horizon should appear to be at an elevation of about 160 meters on a building whose top is almost over 190 meters in elevation. We haven't accounted for atmospheric refraction at all, so our estimate is high, but much more accurate than the flat earth estimate of zero elevation. One of the challenges that flat earthers face is to answer the question, if the earth isn't modeled well by a globe, what is a more accurate model of the earth? The current widely accepted flat earth map is this one. Now, we can use both models, the globe and the disk, to see which one is a better predictor of reality. There are all sorts of problems with this flat earth map, like explaining viewing angles of the sun from around the world that don't fit at all in this model, or why all the earth isn't lit all at once by the sun. I think it is entertaining to see how flat earthers try to get around things like that. For example, claiming that the sun is only 32 miles in diameter. Long distance flight times and paths provide another fun way to test flat earth claims. According to the flat earth model, a flight from Paris, France to Perth, Australia would take a route over Russia and China. However, in reality, flights take a more direct route over Turkey and the tip of India. On a flat earth map, Turkey and India would add thousands of extra kilometers to the journey, making it far from the shortest path. This leads to an economic proof against the flat earth model. If the earth were flat, there would be an opportunity for flat earth airlines to offer cheaper, faster, long distance flights by using these so-called shorter routes. Such a business could potentially be worth hundreds of millions of dollars, so why hasn't any flat earther started this airline? Another evidence is that flight times correlate much more closely to global distances than flat earth distances. In fact, global distances provide almost perfect prediction of flight times, where the flat earth distances for flights, especially those in the southern hemisphere, don't pan out. Well, how do flat earthers refer to the southern hemisphere? The outer rim? The southern hemisphere is where distances get distorted in the Flat Earth model. These points here are the two trips that go from Johannesburg to Australia. Those are very far apart in the Flat Earth model. Perth is 2.2 times as far from Johannesburg than Zurich on the Flat Earth model, but are very close to the same distance on the globe. The flight time to Perth is not twice as much as to Zurich, as the Flat Earthers would predict, but is actually a shorter flight than to Zurich. Let's end with my new argument. It has to do with scientific data on the largest flying birds in the world, the albatross. Many problems with the Flat Earth map deal with the area that most of us refer to as the Southern Hemisphere. In the Flat Earth map, points in the Southern Hemisphere get spread apart, and Antarctica is a giant wall of ice surrounding the entire known Earth. This made me wonder about the amazing wandering albatross, one of the albatross species that's famous for its incredible journeys circumnavigating Antarctica. But on a Flat Earth map, the distances would be astonishingly long. Let's do some math and find out how amazing these birds must be according to Flat Earthers. Let's say a circumnavigating wandering albatross took this path, staying on this latitude line. To figure out this distance, I need a scale for the Flat Earth map. There were two grid intersections here and here, and found the distance between those to be about 2,300 kilometers. In GeoGebra, the distance is about 0.69. So every distance of 0.69 converts to 2,300 kilometers. Now between two grid intersections on the albatross path, the GeoGebra distance is about 1.18. That converts to a distance of 3,941 kilometers. Since it takes 24 segments to complete the circumnavigation, the total distance would be approximately 94,595 kilometers. That's nearly 2.5 times the circumference of the Earth at the equator. That is amazing. Now consider the tagged albatross that completed such a trip in 46 days. To cover 94,595 kilometers in that time, it would need to travel over 2,000 kilometers a day with an average speed of 85.68 kilometers an hour. Adjusting for top speed, the bird would need to reach speeds of 142.2288 kilometers an hour. That would make it the fourth fastest bird in horizontal flight, faster than the peregrine falcon. But there's a problem. Real-world data doesn't support these figures. The albatross is a large bird and can barely fly on its own wing strength. They rely a lot on upward drafts from ocean waves to support long-distance flights. In fact, if the wind dies down for multiple days, albatross are under threat of starvation as they sit in the ocean unable to fly to find food. So how could a bird that can barely fly on its own achieve such speed? Well, they can't. The top recorded speed for a wandering albatross is about 72 kilometers an hour, far below the 142 kilometers an hour needed in the Flat Earth model. Similarly, the farthest documented single-day journey for an albatross is roughly 1,000 kilometers, half of the daily average required for the Flat Earth albatross to complete 94,595 kilometers in 46 days. In reality, the tagged albatross that circumnavigated Antarctica logged a total distance of 21,000 kilometers, closely matching the latitude line I used on the Globe Earth model. This is only about 1/5 of the Flat Earth map's predicted distance, but it aligns perfectly with the globe. The discrepancy between these numbers highlights the flaw in Flat Earth calculations and emphasizes how well the global model fits real-world data. Well, if you're a Flat Earther, please debunk this argument in the comments. If you are not a Flat Earther, please put your favorite evidence for a spherical Earth in the comments. If you know of some far-out excuses or explanations that Flat Earthers give to get around all of this scientific evidence that points to a spherical Earth, put those in the comments also. We will all find them very entertaining.
Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.